Moeraki on the east coast of Otago is famous for its spherical boulders exposed and shaped by the coastal forces of Tangaroa. But as the climate changes and sea levels rise, those forces are ramping up. For coastal Māori communities, this threatens homes, food and even whānau, with many urupā or graveyards now in danger of being washed away. But te tiro whakamuri kia koke whakamua, Tāmati Rimene-Sproat finds a community looking back to move forward.
Te tai o ārai te uru. The coast where the ancient waka ārai te uru was shipwrecked. Here, Tangaroa's power is easy to see and feel, the land shaped by the sea. And with climate change causing sea levels to rise, Tangaroa is getting closer and closer.
I grew up here and I had the most wonderful power and tower you could imagine, my grandparents, who lived here all of their lives, from the day they were born until the day they died.
For David Higgins, Tangaroa is a tipuna.
I have a huge respect for Tangaroa.
Tangaroa has provided for David and his whānau for generations.
I spend a lot of time with my grandfather, who was a well-known fisherman. My great-grandfather was a well-known fisherman, and my great-great-grandfather was a well-known fisherman. So we learnt that mātauranga of he mahi kaika at a very young age.
Also passed down the family fishing business.
And that's what I did, and never left.
David's deep connection to this coast comes from his whakapapa.
Ko te tai o arai te uru te moana, ko kā te māmui, me kai tahu whānui, te iwi.
This is the remains of a cooking midden, probably from the kā te māmui iwi. They were travellers, and they would have stopped here and utilised this area as a campsite.
So how old would this be approximately?
It's hard to say, but I estimate 200 to 300 years.
This is where your ancestors sat and had a kai. This is history.
David is the upoko of Te Runaka o Moeraki.
I'm probably seen as the spiritual leader of the whānau here in Moeraki. I've been upoko since the mid-1980s, this last century.
Part of his role is to oversee the preservation of sites like this.
And these are all?
They're all hangi stones. This one in particular is a good example. You can see the red of the fire burn. And they actually still smell like smoke.
It's amazing.
Aren't they?
Yeah. Still got the shells protruding too.
And some of the kaimoana that was collected and consumed here on this site, yeah.
The sea gives, but it's taking more and more back.
There's a lot of these areas now exposed on the coast.
Archaeologists can only study and record what's left.
Then hopefully some of these areas can be covered, either with heavy rock or with more sand to ensure that they're secure in situ.
And this is obviously a flow-on effect of climate change.
Yes, the tides are getting higher, washing further into the estuaries and up the creeks. So there's going to be an effect on the coastal landscape as a result.
This is my papa taiga. I grew up here. This is home.
Naola Tipa's tipuna migrated here in 1837, led by Ngai Tahu Tohunga Tira Morehu, who saw Moeraki as a refuge for his people.
100 years ago, it was about 6 metres of land in front of these scrubs. When there's a king tide, all of these front cribs flood.
Tangaroa leaves his mark. This crib, once used by Kerry Hume, author of The Bone People, sits abandoned, too close now to be safe from the sea.
This is our whenua, so for us it's about how do we try and protect it, at least for our lifetime, to give our tamariki and our mokopuna the opportunity to enjoy this place as much as we do.
As whānau, as a hapu, how have you tried to slow down some of the erosion that's happening here.
So when you look around here, you've got native plants, the harakeke, that has been planted in order to soak up some of the moisture. In recent years, our unaka has put in all of these boulders here. And if you look along here, you can see the people who own the cribs have put in all these big concrete piles, concrete blocks, concrete stone to try and stop the erosion, because sometimes the seed goes right over the roofs of some of those cribs.
How do you stop Tangaroa?
Well, we don't stop him, but we can slow him down maybe a little.
There's no way of stopping that, because the sea is just almighty, really.
This place means the marae and all the kai that is provides sustenance for us. We're well known for our koda and for our blue cod. The rising temperature of the sea has meant that the blue cod numbers have dropped because they like cold water. And what we're noticing is the kelp beds are thinning out, and with that is the food of the pāua. And so how do we sustain that? What we are doing to try and help whānau, if they should ever find themselves without kai or without money, is we hold wānanga and we show them how to get a pāua, but we actually need the kai there to be able to show them these skills. That is a real threat to our ecosystem and the way that we live as Māori.
Coming up, lapping at the edges of a sacred site.
It's starting to get into the urupā, yes.
And finding hope in uncertainty.
It conjures up all sorts of opportunities.
Generations ago, urupā locations were chosen to keep loved ones close.
We're up on top of Tikuraki urupā.
There are six urupā here in Moeraki, each belonging to different hapū. They're more than just resting places.
They're our whakapapa. They're our traditions, they're our history. And that's the importance to us of those urupā. They're not a living thing, but to us, all that spirit is still there within that place.
But this place is falling away with every strong tide.
These posts were put in the 1960s. You can imagine this line of posts joining up with that concrete post in the far distance.
So that's this whole
That's how much we've lost since that period.
Wow. That's a big chunk of whenua.
Yes.
This was the coastline 75 years ago. This is the coastline today.
Whenataitai is in the far corner of a violent beach.
This place is called Tutakahikura, the beach itself, and behind us is Whenataitai, one of the oldest of the urupā on the peninsula.
And one of four urupā at sea level. It's under immediate threat.
We're standing probably 12 to 15 feet away from where the land used to be 2 or 3 years ago. So in the real king tides, the water comes right up into the paddock here. You can see how low-lying it is. And the result is that we end up with water.
Actually inside the urupā.
It's starting to get into the urupā, yes.
How many kōiwi have been exposed here in Moeraki at the six urupā?
Probably in my time, 20. Some of them are partial skeletal remains, some are full kōiwi.
Those kōiwi have all been reburied, but each hapū has a decision to make.
At present, we have differing views as to whether we should translocate or not. I'm of the view that we should leave them. We come from the sea, we return to the sea.
Even so, David worries about what that would mean for descendants of Moeraki wanting to reconnect with their whakapapa.
I have something that's now real that I can take you to show where your ancestors are buried. But if the urupā disappears, I've got to find some other way of actually reconnecting yourself to your whānau. And that's not going to be easy.
Patrick Tipa moved back to Moeraki about 10 years ago with his wife, Nola. They are caretakers here, helping to hold the whenua from the sea for now.
This is Mātea Tera Morehu.
Yep.
He was one of the rangatira that was here.
Mm.
He started the claim for Ngaitahu.
So it's not only important for the people here of Moeraki, but the whole of Ngaitahu.
Yes.
For you personally, is this where you want to be buried?
It is. My mother, father's buried here, and grandparents, great-grandparents are here too.
That's, again, another step closer to the ocean. Does that worry you?
It does. It does. It does a lot.
When his time comes, Patrick still hopes to join his mātua at Kawa, but Nola is looking to Rangi Nui, the sky.
I want to be scattered to the four winds so people don't have to come to one place. They can see me in the sunshine, feel me in the wind.
We have those ātua kaitiaki, and those ātua will care for our kōiwi wherever they may lie.
Kia ora koutou.
In his spare time, David records podcasts.
Its original name is Ōne Kākara.
Some look into the past.
The place of sweet-smelling sands.
Others to the future and the partnership between mātauranga Māori and science.
We've got a project with the Otago University Marine Division. We're going to not only restore some of our kaimoana beds, but we're going to translocate a particular species from one area of our coastline to another.
It's a traditional practice handed down from generation to generation.
We must share always.
In the past, my taua used to sit in the water and go through a process of translocation of very small baby pāua, place them in the pōhā, the kelp bag, and then hand them to the men who would then go and transfer them to different sites. We are doing that here, but we're going to move thousands of stunted growth pāua to allow them to breed easily. So we've got an environment in the future for our children to be able to continue their practicing their skills of mahi mahi hukai, yeah.
I have a message for future generations.
David's podcasts share that mātauranga with those rangatahi to help them adapt in a changing world.
I like the word adaptive, and it conjures up all sorts of opportunities. But we have a saying within kaitahu whānui, as you move forward, you always look back. If you don't do that, you don't know who you are and where you come from.
I've grown up knowing that this is the land of plenty.
We live in hope that we can survive, and not only survive, that we have a sustainable lifestyle here. That those gifts that we have that derive from Tangaroa are available to us in the future.
Kei oku rangatira no Moeraki, tēnā koutou. Now, Te Runanga o Ngaitahu launched its climate change action plan earlier this year. The iwi is aiming for net zero emissions by 2050. A full embrace of renewable energy, protection of its mahinga kai or food resources, and a more resilient future for whānau.